Good morning to all. I, Dr. Anurika Mehta, Associate Professor, Department of Applied Science, Purnima Institute of Engineering and Technology, welcomes you all to the webinar on Algae for Food, Energy and Sustainable Environmental Solutions. It is my privilege to welcome our speaker, Dr. Shailesh Kumar Patidar, sir. He is an Assistant Professor in School for Earth Science, Central University of Rajasthan, Ajmer, since 2019. He has completed his PhD in microbiology from CSIR MK Bhavnagar University in 2015. He has completed his research fellow at University of Michigan, USA, on the topic of biofuels from ecologically designed polyculture in 2019. He has completed his postdoctoral fellowship from Hanyang University, Seoul, South Korea, where he was involved in 3 projects which is related to molecular ecology and psychopharic ecology from 2016 to 2018. He was senior research fellow in Anand Agricultural University, Gujarat in 2009. With teaching experience of 4 years, he has published more than 20 national and international papers, 2 patents and 5 conference papers. With this brief introduction of the speaker, I would like to invite our respected director, Dr. Dinesh Goyal sir, for the words of blessings. Please, sir.
Good morning, everyone. First of all, I welcome Dr. Shailesh Patidar, the academy expert who has spent his valuable time to share his vast knowledge in the field of microbiology to the audience who is from all age groups of starting from age of 18 years to age of 45, 50 years. Today, the food practices of human beings have evolved, and microbiology has played a lot of role in that part. I hope this session will deliver good knowledge to the participants in this series. We expect that participants will enjoy. This is a series of webinars which we have been conducting till now. I think we have conducted more than 30 webinars from all the experts across the country, and in fact, 5 of us have come globally also. So their expertise and knowledge will enlighten and will increase the knowledge spectrum of all the participants here. With this, I welcome Shailesh sir on behalf of PIET. I hope your session will be an asset to all of us. Thank you.
This is Algae for, actually my presentation will be focused on the Algae for Food, Energy and Sustainable Environmental Solutions. I will more concisely actually cover microalgae. Specifically, not macroalgae. Now both are important, but microalgae are of special importance because of their indispensable ecological services as well as their potential for producing food and sustainable environmental solutions. When we talk about algae as a food, when we talk about algae, certainly when we talk about algae, microalgae have special importance. And when we consider microalgae as a food, we know that why it is necessary. When we see this, we can go through certain problems and solutions for microalgae. We know that meat consumption is increasing, actually cancer and heart disease. And at the same time, the meat consumption will not be enough for the population, increasing population in future with burden of nitrogen could not be able to get meat production for making it for everyday life. And then demand, we know that there is a lot of demand for the plant protein to compensate those meat proteins. And we know that it is very proportional to the reduction of the meat consumption as far as the future projection of the population is concerned. And we know that it is one of the it is considered as the critical health issue of microalgae. among the algae, highest after bacteria. We know that a farmer growing corn must pay or at least 120 dose to get their harvest at the crop and then can produce that protein. But algae farmer will produce that in very short period of time of 30 days in photobioreactor or open ponds and can generate three times of a protein than corn. So we can understand that these are the important protein producers. Apart from that, when we consider different kind of microalgae for protein production, spirulina comes at first, but there are certain other microalgae which are also used, for example, Bacillococcus, or we can call upon Metococcus and Tunelilla. These are also a very important microalgae and in addition to the chlorella. But the spirulina and chlorella are more similar. So I'm taking it as an example of spirulina as a nutraceutical. It contains very high digestible proteins and it has a very thin cell wall or almost no cell wall. And then biomass is actually enriched with beta vitamins, B vitamins. And then there are certain phytopigments, for example, phycocyanin, phycoalgin, chlorophyll, and so on, which are very, some of these phycocyanin and phycoalgin, which are part of the phycobilic proteins, are actually having very high antioxidative properties and have anti-cancer properties. It is also enriched with minerals and vitamin E. And of course, it has some essential fatty acids like sulfolipids, which can prevent HIV infection and so on. It is also containing a very high rich metallothionein compounds, which are a kind of proteins which are enriched with a cysteine kind of residues. This cysteine or cysteine kind of other amino acids contains alic group actually is very active and have phyllic action to bind with the heavy metals. So, in that concern, microalgae has very large. Have a very large actually role to play in the future for the food, to replace the food. But when we consider only as a food, it will not come it as a sole player, but definitely if we integrate the microalgal biomass with the other products, for example, all the biomass, it could be converted into certain other products, it will actually the overall cost of the product will decrease. So when we say microalgal cell factory, actually we discuss certain metabolites and macromolecules which could be converted into the biofuel or bioactive compounds or some kind of food compounds, aquafeed or pigments or so on. So the general, when we say polysaccharides from microalgae, it could be enriched with beta 1-3 glucan, which is a kind of gelling agent. It is also a kind of important source of starch and cellulose production. And it could be used in pharmaceutical, human nutrition, and functional foods. When you talk about lipids, especially the polyunsaturated fatty acids, I want to mention that some of the microalgae are actually rich in polyunsaturated fatty acids and hydrocarbon, while some of them are actually enriched with the saturated fatty acids. So here, if we selectively actually work on the microalgae which are actually polyunsaturated rich, then we can say that those far rich compounds could be used in pharmaceuticals, nutraceuticals, food technology, and energy creation. They have very major role to play in the arthritis and some of the other important compounds. Which are important particles for the brain functions and so on. Some of the bioactive compounds also include terpenes, various antibacterial, antiviral, or antifungal compounds, which could be extracted from the microalgae and could be utilized as a fine chemical antibiotic, vaccine cosmetics, or some kind of agrochemicals. For example, some of the biopesticides are also could be made from the algae. recently I came across some news that some of the scientists are working on the COVID-19 to get some biopsy from plants on the this coronavirus and coronavirus family. Some white holisters, for example, the talk about bioplastic, that could be also produced by the algae, because algae releases so many exopolymer compounds from their cell wall. And these are the biodegradable plastics, so that can be very essential. Essentially, I must say that it would have a great future if we could have a biodegradable plastics, and that would be also of the affordable cost, so we can replace the problems of the plastics and the some of the endocrine disruptor type of compounds. So definitely, they have a major role to play. Then proteins, I already discussed that it is a protein. Apart from micro, in the 1960s, there is lots of work on the algae to create a fuel from the algae, from different components of microalgae, for example, from the carbohydrate to bioethanol and lipid to biodiesel. So, here I have mentioned a specific example of Tetracelmestrata, one of the promising marine microalgae for the humans, which could be actually produced in the artificially optimized condition in the photobioreactor, as well as it could be controlled in the open pond condition or waste ponds, and could be supplemented with the CO2 and some waste water. And so, actually, microalgae is actually capturing a CO2, which is a major problem, and then, of course, a nutrients from the wastewater, which is also a kind of waste source, which we are using it as a nutrient source for the microalgae, and we can optimize the condition of the light, temperature, CO2, and so on. So we could produce a maximum biomass from in a very short time by this certain microalgae, and then this biomass after harvesting could be utilized for oil extraction, and that oil can be converted into biodiesel, or it can be some of the glyceride will be also produced as a byproduct. We can again have a bio oil by direct thermo liquefaction. We can also have a biohydrogen production using algae. And we can, all the carbohydrate could be actually converted into bioethanol and biogas. So in overall, it is a complete biorefinery where all of the components of the microalgal biomass could be converted into the fuel, and whatever rest actually remains could be utilized as a fertilizer. So microalgae in that seems quite promising. When we talk about global warming and climate change, microalgae are not behind. They are one of the most potential candidates for the capturing CO2 and sequestering CO2. When we see the protected CO2 in the troposphere by various studies, it is about to reach 1000 ppm by the end of this century. And we know that carbon dioxide is a major actually greenhouse gas, and it's global warming potential would be lesser, but the proportion of total effect apart from the water problem is the maximum. So we can say that it is the major contributor to the global warming. And if we want to combat this, definitely microalgae has a role to play. When we talk about the carbon pool of the Earth, definitely when we talk about different type of atmosphere, lithosphere, biospheric portion, we have a different kind of gigaton carbon inside as a carbon pool. When we see the aquatic biota, it seems less, but the potential of capturing and sequestering CO2 of the by the microalgae or aquatic microalgae is huge. It almost contributed 40% of the total carbon capture of the Earth. So you can imagine that if there will be no microalgae or carbon, you cannot imagine the global average temperature or to maintain the temperature. When we talk about carbon sequestration, I will define it in a two mode. One is the autotrophic mode and another is isotropic or mesotrophic mode. So algae is utilize organic carbons like lactose, glucose, ferric, ammonium citrate, glycerol, or any type of waste sugar sources or glycerol sources which could be utilized by microalgae. Even some of the most, you can say, recalcitrant compounds which could not be degraded by the common microorganism, algae would be able to do that in addition to the bacteria. So there is a role of algae. Importantly, when we talk about the autotrophic mode, definitely some dissolved nitrogen and dissolved organic carbon is necessary, but at the same time, algae could sequester autotrophically photosynthesis, and then that photosynthetic CO2 capture could be converted into a biomass. When we talk about CO2, there are different modes of the CO2 uptake in the microalgae. CO2, obviously, when dissolved into the aquatic system or water, it will be converted into bicarbonate or bicarbonate according to the pH. So the chemical speciation of CO2 will depend on the pH of the water or nutrient solution. So, but of course, when these all three species are present, CO2, carbonate, and bicarbonate, definitely they have a different kind of accumulation to affect the bicarbonate, carbonate, or CO2 by the microalgae. And eukaryotic and prokaryotic cyanobacteria have a different kind of strategy to uptake those carbonate, bicarbonate, or CO2 through the direct or indirect uptake. There is a role to play by the telescope as well as the carbonate and bicarbonate. So, when we talk about basic overview, definitely whatever goes inside as a light plus CO2 in the autotrophic will ultimately give some kind of carbohydrate, and after carbohydrate at the photosynthesis, it could be again converted to the lipid. So there is a pathway where carbohydrate will be again partitioned into the lipids and proteins. So, and at the same time, when we talk about the heterotrophic growth does not require any CO2, but it will utilize organic carbon, whatever the sugar or any glycerol or any other kind of source available to the algae, it will convert it ultimately into the lipids, and those oil bodies, which we call the triacyl glycerol, could be utilized for the biodiesel production. So I'm taking here an example of a monorepidium manifium, one of the most potential microalgae which I encountered during my PhD, and that has ultimate potential of the carbon sequestration and lipid production in varying growth mode, even in the heterotrophic condition or photoautotrophic condition, wherein we actually optimize the two gas as a CO2 source and then NPK sources and biodiesel glycerin, which is one of the byproducts of the actual biodiesel production process, glucose, fructose, and sodium. We actually use these sources one by one in a different proportion and analyze the growth of this specific monorepidium molecule for productivity, and also optimize the lipid productivity there. Monorepidium manifium in the stationary phase actually building up lipids, and it was harvested in the stationary phase, and then lipid was extracted, and using methanolic KH and chloroform, we could convert that into oil. That bio oil is actually converted into using transesterification process, converted into a biodiesel, which made with the European and American petroleum. When we talk about the experimental details, this is one of the experimental detail of that study where we actually used a different kind of pH control strategies and also had a different pH, and nutrient medium was the same, but the light period pH or pH control strategy was different. So we also used a different type of composition of gases which transfers to the photobioreactor. So we actually controlled the gas control as well as flow rate, and then there was different growth mode of autotrophic or heterotrophic or mesotrophic conditions. When we could Here you can see that algae is actually grown into a different organic sources, on different organic sources, and we found that the biomass productivity was highest in the fructose condition, while the total lipid was highest in the biodiesel feed, which is one of the products of the biodiesel. So it was like the waste source which we used for the photobioreactor in the phototrophic growth of the in the mixo phototrophic growth of the microalgae, where we got the phototropically very high biomass productivity. And overall, if you see the lipid product, both lipid and biomass productivity was very high in most of the conditions in the microalgae. These are the some photobioreactor experiments where we did a certain kind of biomass productivity and total lipid percentage estimation under different varying conditions. And we can see that actually the D and E conditions are food gas conditions wherein we found higher biomass productivity. In the E condition, we also added biodiesel glycerin. Now we got higher biomass lipid percentage was somewhat less because we some lipid was actually deteriorated or you can say peroxidized during the peroxidation of the antioxidant due to reactive oxygen food loss. But overall, we have seen that the total lipid percentage was very high under continuous CO2 conditions and xeric media conditions, but the biomass productivity was maximum in the mixotrophic or heterotrophic condition. And we compare both biomass productivity and total lipid percentage. 30% flue gas with the continuous light condition was the best condition for the growth of the microalgae. These are the some total organic carbon details and dissolved organic carbon in the medium while microalgae was growing in the photobioreactor condition. Here you can, I am not going into much detail, but you can see that POC was almost increasing in each case with respect to the biomass production. And then the dissolved organic carbon is actually not directly proportional, at least for the condition E, where actually dissolved organic carbon was utilized for the growth. So this seems that it is the phototrophic mode was actually converted into photoheterotrophic mode on the day 10 because we added some glycerin inside the photobioreactor, and that actually there was some switch on of the growth mode of microalgae into heterotrophic mode, which reduced the dissolved organic carbon concentration. These are some trends of the inorganic nitrate, nitrite, and phosphate. You can see that nitrate and phosphate was actually renewal rate was so high in the condition A, where biomass productivity was the where total lipid and biomass productivity was higher. And then we can also see that in the condition D and condition C, you can see that they also have a nitrite. This nitrite is built up due to flue gas exposure to the flue gas purging in the photobioreactor. And flue gas contains a nitrate, but that some NO2 will be converted, nitrogen oxide will be converted into nitrite also, and that could be consumed by the microalgae. So this, most of the microalgae actually are not effective to remove the nitrite, because nitrite is somewhat acidic, but Monorepidium manutum could actually consume that nitrite. And this is the sign of a very highly tolerant microalgae, which is very, very, you can say that very effective bioremediation potential has. Yeah, these are the trend of outlet CO2. You can see that when biomass started to build up, flue gas actually outlet CO2 concentration is getting lower and lower, and at the end of the 20K or at the end of the growth, it was almost consumed up to 90% in the nutrient solution by the biomass production. And here it is, there are some white patches which are indicating that lipid production there. There was larger lipid body, L is showing lipid body. So you can see that in this stationary course, it is building up. And when we see a particularly a CO2 exposure, when CO2 concentration was higher, we have seen that lipid bodies were actually and we could see enlargement of the lipid bodies. When we talk about CHNS composition and C by N of lyophilized microalgal biomass of optimum lipid, in most of the conditions, we could see that the carbon by nitrogen ratio is actually varying between 5.1 to 10.18, and we also have seen that when the lipid production was maximum, at the same time carbon to nitrogen ratio was higher. This shows that under nitrogen limitation, microalgae produce higher lipid concentration or lipid content. So in that way, we can actually tune the fatty acid composition of the monorepidium minicum. Different applying different flue gas concentration, light condition, and pH condition. And at the same time, we can actually, in the heterotrophic growth mode, we can change the organic substrate. And in that way, we can actually tune the fatty acid composition of the microalgae. Please note that these are the fatty acids which will be converted into the bioreactor. So if we have a more monounsaturated and saturated fatty acid, we will be able to get more biodiesel. While if we have more polyunsaturated fatty acid, we could get more biodiesel glycerol, and there is a kind of a lower biodiesel production. So when we need more polyunsaturated fatty acid, it is advised that we will go for the photoacid condition. While when we need more unsaturated monounsaturated fatty acids for the biodiesel production, we will go for the flue gas based CO2 sparging and then optimum pH condition. So these are some estimated biodiesel properties. All of the biodiesel properties of monorepidium met with the European biodiesel standards and American biodiesel standards. And you can see that all of the actually parameters are well fitted with the standard. This is one of the another study where we haven't used photobioreactor biomass. Rather, we used actually naturally floating algal mat. Here in the background, you can see those naturally floating algal mat, which harvested easily. So actually, this naturally floating algal mat does not require any kind of centrifugation or advanced harvesting technique. They can be simply skimmed off from the aquatic body, and we can collect those. We actually sun-dried those microspora mat and dried it on the under sunlight condition in an open environment, and then by the ball milling process, we actually crush it, that biomass into a fine powder, and that fine dry powder actually kept into the 50-liter bioreactor for the lipid extraction. We did lipid extraction and then converted that into a algal biodiesel. And this is the Tavera run by the CSNCRI by using B100 biodiesel. Which was the first of its kind in the world when this happened. So you can see that the floating microalgal mat could be utilized as a bioremediation as well as biofuel production. Bioremediation, why? Because actually when they grow in the aquatic body, actually they could concentrate very high concentration of the heavy metals. And in that way, they are cleaning all the heavy metals. And when there is a low bioaccumulation concentration factor for the heavy metals, we got very high lipid production. So in those conditions, in the pre-monsoon condition, we got very high biomass productivity. In the monsoon condition, we got very low bioaccumulation concentration factor of heavy metals, but still they were getting, there was some moderate growth. In the post monsoon, we got moderate growth with very high lipid percentage. So that is the one of the factors to get all the biomass in the post monsoon and then converted into the bio. This is one of the another study which where we used actually chlorella variables, and then we changed the continuous CO2, and so we can say that we actually changed the inorganic carbon supply. It could be in the form of the 1% continuous CO2, or it would be in the form of the sodium bicarbonate, or it was in the intermittent fashion. It was actually sparge into the photobioreactor with air at 1% concentration. And we got very high total lipid content. When we use 1% continuous CO2, we get very higher biomass. We got very higher biomass productivity when we use sodium bicarbonate as an inorganic carbon source. And we got very moderate biomass productivity when we use 1% intermittent CO2. We found that this strategy is very impressive, because when we get both biomass and lipid productivity up to the moderate level, we get actually higher lipid productivity. That is very important. And we also did some another experiment where we actually sparged CO2 into the specific compartment and kept all the glasses inside, all the glass of the algal culture glass inside. And we have observed that in the high CO2 condition, lipid productivity was higher, but biomass productivity was less. By the low CO2 concentration, biomass productivity was higher, but so overall, if there will be some point of the high to low CO2, there will be some ranging point where the lipid productivity will be the maximum, and we try to optimize that with the pH. So we could actually modulate saturated fatty acids and monounsaturated fatty acids and to convert into a biodiesel. This was also patented by the CSMCRI, the biodiesel produced by this specific microorganism. When we talk about the algae, I already discussed this point where we could convert that into a different biofuel sources, but we need high biomass with high lipids for sustainable bioproduction at affordable cost, and that is very important. So whatever we are doing is actually optimizing all of the conditions required for the cultivation, as well as lower down the cost of the harvesting process, and at the end, if we could optimize conditions where we get the higher fatty acids, which could be converted to biodiesel, could be considered as an effective process. So there are different strategies to modify the microalgae. One is the molecular biology tool, by which we can use some molecular tools and can actually figure the lipid production or biomass production or capture higher CO2. But there is another promising strategy where we do not need any kind of molecular tools, and we can change the biomass and lipid productivity, and we use that technique. This was the first of its kind where we actually isolated some specific algae with their phycosphere. We actually screened those bacteria which were actually attaching to the microalgae. We separated those bacteria, and one by one, with all the bacteria, we tested the algae, and we could find that there are certain microalgae which actually have a very specific mutualistic interaction with the bacteria. We identified such bacteria, that is Pelagica bermudensis, which was actually having a mutualistic interaction with the certain bacteria, and they were benefiting each other and promoting the growth of the microalgae. So we could enhance up to 3 times of the algal biomass productivity by simply adding this bacteria. So we know that actually high-speed engineering is very important because most of the actually we see the when we see the optimizing condition, it will be rather dependent on the physical chemical factor. And when we talk about the intracellular practice precursors, generally this will be depending on the molecular or physiological factors. But suppose if we change the extracellular metabolite by using certain bacteria, we can actually modulate physical chemical factors as well as intracellular precursors. Why I am saying physical chemical factors? Because they can mitigate the stress. For example, salinity stress or other stress could be mitigated by the bacteria to enhance the growth of the microorganism. When we talk about the future, there is a future where we can do lots of using synthetic biology tools and synthetic ecology tools to enhance the CO2 sequestration potential, lipids or carbohydrates or carbon capture. So, utmost important is metabolic engineering for understanding the effect of the carbon, nitrogen and phosphorus allocation on proteoacid synthesis, because when this tree will change, definitely there will be a diversion of the biochemical routes to produce the lipid or carbohydrate or any other. Then there are synthetic biological approaches where we can use genetic transformation for improvement in carbon fixation. For example, I'm giving an example here. If we could modify the Rubisco structure, or if we could enhance the property of the Rubisco where CO2 could be actually intact for a larger period of time. Because when we talk about Rubisco is quite slippery molecule. It will not capture CO2 particularly with very ease. The actual potential is very less compared to other catalytic or enzymatic enzymes. But it is the only, you can say, macromolecule, biological macromolecule which captures CO2. And that is why it captures CO2 in the cell membrane. And that is why it is very important, because it has so many functions. And if we could change or trigger the efficiency of the Rubisco, it could be a bigger, you can say, canvas to generate multiple compounds at the end, because it will trigger the biomass productivity. There are different approaches, for example, synthetic ecology and synthetic biology, where we can actually apply flue gas or wastewater nutrients as a carbon or nutrient source. And definitely, if we use it, it will cause effective process. At the same time, we can overexpress Rubisco. We can also augment the fatty acid concentration by incorporating bacterial genes or microorganism genes to the host cell to overexpress food precursors, so they can make more food precursors, which we could actually convert into the biodiesel. And there will be another study where overexpression of thiosterase enzyme is also dealt with. So that is also one of the another promising strategy. And there are certain strategy where we can actually enhance the overall productivity of the other products, for example, carotenoids or phycosanin or carotenoid or so on under CO2 stress conditions. So why it is important? Because if the microalgae is able to produce higher biomass productivity or you can say a lipid productivity under high CO2 stress condition, it could capture higher CO2 and nutrient also. And that is why the overall process becomes highly cost effective, and we could generate a range of variety of products from the single biomass. And that is very important. So this is the end of my story here. I acknowledge CSIR, CSMCRI, and then Hanyang University, South Korea, University of Michigan, USA, and Central University of Rajasthan, and all my mentors, my supervisors, co-supervisors, co-authors, and friends are highly acknowledged for this work. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. for your very informative session. We have some queries from the participants. Some of the participants want to ask which species you choose for reference.
Dr. P.T. Jade, which species you choose for reference? Reference means what? Actually, I studied Monorepidium menitum, Tetrasalmix prieta, Nanochloropsis, many more microalgal species. I worked on many species, but I don't know what you want to say. If it is about biofuel or if it is about bioproducts or any other, it's a different strain. Yes, so that is what the strain, the product will be specific to the strain. So if there is a strain which is actually good for the biofuel, we can go for that microalgal strain for producing higher biomass or biofuel. And if we have another product, we need to concentrate on that product. Yeah, that is the thing. And second, Shakti Kumar Giledar, which type of crop should require to give more calorific value or biomass? Should require to give more calorie or biomass. Crop means what kind of crop? Are you talking about biofuel crop? So if we say a calorific value of the microalgae is lesser than the terrestrial crops. But overall, we are not converting biomass into a kind of biogas, where we need calorific value of biomass. We are converting biomass into the biodiesel, and there we have enough biomass in a very short time. So very important to have algae, because algae have all those qualities. Okay?
Right, sir.
And Vicky Srivastav.
Okay, sir, if possible, please. Okay, fine. This webinar is also uploaded on YouTube. When it will be uploaded on the Purdima Group TV channel, we will send you the link for the same. Don't worry.
Okay. Is there any other question that I could answer?
Yes, sir. One of the participants, Dr. Pratibha Singh, wants to ask something. You can also check it on your question answer box.
Algae are better than macroalgae for biofuel production?
Right, sir.
So, yes, definitely microalgae are better than macroalgae for the biofuel, because macroalgae do not have that much biomass productivity as microalgae. Microalgae are quite microorganism kind of compound, microorganisms. So, they can be grown in the photobioreactors very easily, and within very short time, it could produce very high biomass. And secondly, we can control it into a photobioreactor. Most of the macroalgae, we could not control it effectively in the photobioreactor. Even we could control it, could not give that much biomass production. It requires more land, and they are not a kind of microorganism. So there are multiple issues with them. However, there are studies where macroalgae could be converted into a biofuel, and there is also a kind of debate, because it could not produce that much macroalgae in a laboratory condition. We need to go to the open coastal ways or waterways or open coastal area where we could produce, but there are certain environmental impacts of that. So people are not considering macroalgae as a promising for the biofuel as they feel for the microalgae.
Okay, fine, sir. One more question. What will be the maximum octane or cetane rating we get from algal biofuels to be used in motor vehicles?
Actually, I don't know the octane and cetane rating about my microalgal biodiesel, so I have no idea. But definitely, whatever microalgae we produced, actually we got all the European, we met with all the European standards and American standards. So you can refer my some of the papers and patents where it has been mentioned very clearly, and some of the another papers where microalgals, you can say a biodiesel property, have been discussed in detail. So there you can get octane and cetane rating. So overall, as I know, it is fitting with all of the parameters of the algal biofuel. Yeah, all of the parameters for the fuel required for the biofuel.
fine. One more question is, how can we do LCA of biofilm protection?
There are different software for the life cycle assessment. I do not know, I'm not remembering the name exactly, but there are certain software. So what we are requiring is that there are two conditions for that, for life cycle assessment. One is we need to do certain experiments and we need to identify those parameters which could affect overall economically or the intensification of the process or energy. Okay, so definitely the most of the parameters are based on the energy and environment. For example, the cost of the nutrient or the type of the nutrient, or the, you can say that what will happen if all of the microalgae will be biomass will be harvested, and what will happen to the remaining nutrient water, for example, if we are not recycling it. Okay, because it will it will also contain lots of dissolved organic carbon concentration. At the same time, how efficient it is to remove nitrogen and phosphorus and other heavy metals, that is also important concern. And then there is a cost of the harvest, where we, if we use, for example, a centrifugation, it is more costly. If we do other, if we go for another harvesting method, they are different. They have a different energy requirement. So overall, the process should be quite cost effective. At the same time, it should be quite simple. So these are the parameters very important for the life cycle assessment. And overall, those of the products which are generated side by or as byproduct, can we utilize it as a product in some process or not? Also important.
Yeah. Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Now I would like to end up the session with a vote of thanks. So I, Mohit Vajpayee, Assistant Professor in Department of Applied Science, Kodima Institute of Engineering and Technology, I would like to extend my vote of thanks on behalf of my department. So first of all, I would like to thank Dr. Shade, sir, a very informative session delivered by you. And it is a very precious time you shared with all of us. I would also like to thank the participants who would join the session. And surely the topic and the solutions of algae in different aspects like food, energy, and sustainable environment will going to enhance their knowledge in various aspects. So I would like to thank all the participants and all the committee members of the department who will be the backbone of the webinar. None other than our technical team, Yatin sir, also did the very difficult task to organize the sessions. So thank you so much all. Wonderful day ahead. Thank you so much. And the participants, your feedback link will be shared in the chat box also, and also be delivered to the mail to you. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, Shailesh sir, for finding a time with us. It's a very great session by you. Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. Okay. And all of the participants.